Why is he going to Tulsa, Oklahoma on Juneteenth? And is the White House aware of the controversy that has caused and the real alarm that it's caused among some Republicans even about what it's saying to the country about that sensitive day?
Well, the White House is certainly aware of the controversy and the history now. My reporting is that when the campaign chose this date, it was unintentional. They were not aware of the history of either Juneteenth or the racist massacre in Tulsa. And then once they found out, they decided to move ahead. I was told the president in particular was not concerned about any of the safety implications, be it those of coronavirus, where it's worth noting that there's a waiver that people who attend the rally basically have to click and sign that says if they do get coronavirus, they will not hold the campaign or the president responsible, or about the safety implications of going into this city on this date, in this moment in the nation with such racial unrest and protests and what that might mean for the city and protesters clashing with Trump supporters, clashing with the police. He just decided to forge ahead.
Wes, can you jump in here a little bit about the significance of Juneteenth and the president's visit? The White House says, based on Ashley's reporting, they're kind of unaware of the significance. So what is the significance, Wes?
Sure. And frankly, that's a pretty remarkable true thing, right? You know, clearly, really good reporting from Ashley and others there. It is pretty remarkable that the White House or the President of the United States might not be aware of the significance of Juneteenth. When you have the Emancipation Order that frees the slaves, this is something that's largely regarded as, you know, an unofficial black holiday. It's something that's very important. It's a type of thing that perhaps, you know, a former President Obama might have put a statement out on to acknowledge. And so it is very interesting. Going back in time for one second to one thing you were talking about, I was thinking this as Jake was talking about his excellent reporting from the Hill, and your note earlier about how is this like the gun control debate. Mm-hmm. One thing that's really interesting, purely from a policy standpoint, not from a politics standpoint, one thing that's really interesting here is that even the Democrats' bill, even if they get everything, it is very similar to some of the things that get proposed after gun control, where, in fact, passing this legislation into law tomorrow is, in fact, still unlikely to prevent us from seeing another one of these videos next week. It's the type of thing that, and that's not to say I'm not weighing in one way or the other on whether or not they should do the things in the bill or should not, but it's the type of thing where, you know, having background checks objectively would not stop some of these mass shootings, right? A federal ban on chokeholds would not have, in fact, kept George Floyd alive, right? So it's one of those cases where there's some, you know, everyone wants to do something, and also, you know?
Let's stick with that. That's an important point from Wes. Andrea, what else is needed to address systemic racism? If having body cameras on police officers captures racism in action, how do you actually prevent racism from being a trait that you see in police forces across the country? Does anyone in Washington have an answer to that question?
Well, I think the answers that are proposed include recruitment and training and also penalties and enforcement, where the police chiefs, the leadership, have to be willing to punish people, also to not indemnify them. And to one proposal is to have insurance companies, to use the economic incentives, to have insurance companies insure these locations when they are found to violate people's rights, so that it's not being paid if there are payments being made to families of victims. They're not coming out of tax dollars. They're coming out of insurance companies. Premiums will be raised on the cities, and people, elected officials, will begin to pay attention. That's one of the innovative approaches. You're not going to eliminate systemic racism, but you can change training and you can change recruitment and bring into the police departments the kind of people who care about not reaching for a weapon or a knee or some other way of mm-hmm. of murdering a victim in 8 minutes and 46 seconds. That's the horror of what happened here.